Hi, this is Maestro Lieflander with my video series on my book, Borrowed Arias for Sacred Use. This music book is a collection of famous arias taken from classical operas and oratorios, arranged by me for sacred or church use. This is a 20-part series that explains the changes I made and the context from which they came. Join me in discovering the divine in all good and noble music. Let's jump right into our first example. From the opera Rinaldo by Handel, the famous aria Lascia ch'io piaccia. It is about the heroine Almirena, who is being captured by the enemy and is now in jail. King Argante is chasing after her and wants to marry her. But she is bemoaning now in jail her captivity, asking for mercy and freedom in this most beautiful, heart-wrenching aria.
So we are sitting here in this beautiful church that you saw in the intro, and luckily where I live, we are surrounded in the tiniest village has churches like this. It's unbelievable, and that truly allows one to contemplate the finer things in life and for the soul. So this piece here, I've translated and put into sacred context by listening to it many, many times and thinking, what does it say to me? What does the music only say to me? So not in a performance, not in that, just the pure melody and harmony. What do they speak of? And if you look a little bit into the history of this melody, you can find and see that it was used many times by Handel, and especially the part A was used in several oratorios and sort of secular oratorios and in some operas too beforehand. But it was the first part was often in a more happy context. And what I hear in the part A, in this beautiful, is a certain majesty, a certain something very important is told to us, and told from somebody to us, rather us speaking with it. And so I've decided to put the text from Romans 14:8 for the first part underneath there. For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. And so that's what it speaks to me, is that it's a statement, and it's a beautiful statement, and it is an absolute statement. This has nothing to do with my emotions or with anybody else's emotions. This is how it is. And so the words fit very nicely underneath. I have then also, for our hardcore Catholic friends, of this channel, translated it. Well, I didn't translate it. I took the Vulgate Bible and took the Latin text straight out of the Bible. Sive vivemus, domino vivimus. Now comes the second part, this part B, which is about the same length as part A. And here it becomes emotional. Here in the opera, she pleads for her freedom and she pleads for mercy as she does that. And but there's an incredible yearning for me in here that I hear in that music. And so I found this text, a very famous text, and it's often used in the Catholic liturgy. Jesus dulcis memoria, dans vera cordis gaudia, sed super mer et omnia, eius dulcis presentia. This is a famous Latin prayer that has many, many, many stanzas. This is just the first two of it. And I have also a beautiful translation for this for our non-hardcore friends of this channel. And it's a beautiful poetic translation by Edward Caswell. And the words are, Jesus, the very thought of thee with sweetness fills the breast, yet sweeter far thy face to see and in thy presence rest. No voice can sing, no heart can frame, nor can the memory find a sweeter sound than Jesus' name, the Savior of mankind. And that's the longing that I hear in that part B, that we want to be close to be to Jesus, that his presence fills our heart and breast with sweetness, and this longing towards him, and that we ask that he remember us. And that's where the Jesus Dulcis Memoria comes in. So we have, and of course, the Jesus Dulcis Memoria reminds one a little bit of the good thief, the story of the good thief, where Jesus is being asked, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And that then, of course, fits very well together with part A, for whether we live unto the Lord or die unto the Lord. It all ties in very, very nicely together. So without further ado, and I will speak about the changes that I made to this aria beforehand, I will sing it twice, once first and then some commentary in Latin and then in German translation, because Jesus dir leb ich is a big deal among German Protestants that shows up very often in the liturgies. And so It gets you right here. It's one of those things. So, I will now sing the German version of it. And by the way, leave me a comment below if you would like a copy of this aria or for any other arias that are coming up in any parts. I will respond to the comments. So this is the German version, and it sounds not quite as good. Latin is just the ideal language to sing. German has too much in it in order to be really the ideal singing language. But I wanted to point out a couple of musical things. This piece lives and dies, the text, with two things. Number one is these beautiful breaks where the music itself still continues even though there is no sound coming. These beautiful breaks that define it. No sound. It's one of the attributes of music. And the second one is that it's three-quarter rhythm, but it's fairly well hidden. It's a saraband, but it's fairly well hidden. The accents should belong to B2, but if you do an earlier performance, sort of earlier music practice, you still put the accent on one. One, two, three. But if you were to make a more romantic performance, you would actually put the accent on the two, which then offsets from the bar line where the action is and drives this piece on in spite of its slow tempo and in spite of all of its breaks that it has in there. And both of this is a great expressive tool that the composer Handel used for this. And which in part is the reason why it makes such a classic, this piece. So I will now do the
Thank you.
truly the divine in music. The reason why I'm doing this is that still, like 200 years ago, the only time that, that quote-unquote regular people get to hear good music, if they're lucky to belong to a church that has it, is actually in the church. Even though we have record players and we have everything else, the popular taste nowadays is not this kind of music. But I know that when people sit in the pews, even if they're distracted, even if there was a too long sermon and everybody's restless or so, beautiful and noble music brings the focus to why you are here. And people are receptive in this context to all these great arias and the great music that has been given to us as a great gift over the centuries from God Himself. And so this is a vehicle to reach people and to have them discover something within themselves that they didn't know existed, and to also just simply expose them to all the beauty that is out there. And so that's why I took these classics, because sometimes, like for example this aria, somebody might have heard it beforehand, and the fact that these are maybe to some familiar cuts right into the heart. All of a sudden it all makes sense when you've heard it a second time or so. And the reaction that I usually get to these arias and to this book when I use it in many different churches, such as this, or in other churches, even in very modern churches, is one of being profoundly stirred. I often have a lineup at the balcony asking me, what was that? What was that? And can I buy a CD of that? And what? Where did this come? This is beautiful. And people being profoundly thankful. Unfortunately to me, I didn't write this, I just arranged it. But the thanks, of course, goes to Handel, who made himself an instrument to pass on this divinity. So that's a little bit about the background, why this book exists. And for any professional musicians who are listening it, again, leave a comment down below and a way to reach you, and I can send you for a small amount, either single arias or the entire book. It's all electronically available. So that concludes part one of this, and I see you soon again for part two.